Another way to eliminate the uninteresting component. Then you have a simple differential equation only in CF. Now we only have CF here and CF here.
Yeah, go ahead.
And that equation you basically can solve in the perturbative wave here, the sheets. Do you still have the sheets? Let me see. Then I will try to remember how it works. Okay. So in principle, I can then write the CF equals HF minus E times CF H. Is that the one I want to do the other one? 2 times inverse? Yes, 2 times inverse, that's interesting. Inverse V transpose HC minus E minus 1 V and C. And this one you can solve perturbatively.
So the solution that we got is perturbative.
Yes, from this idea, the perturbative series, with the whole series.
One series. Complete.
And?
The complete one series that you can sum.
So, I define as a potential more than infinity. I define as a potential V equals Vt Hc minus V. And then I write down the whole word series. So let's get started. Oh yeah, maybe you better do it for the paper actually. Because I just write down, so first the word term, and then you have the next term, and then the next term, and you can continue this till infinity. As usual, Liebmann Schwinger, I think. Is it a Liebmann Schwinger equation? Something similar.
It's similar to Liebmann Schwinger, but it's not different.
So the first thing we have to see is the the expansion, this one. So that's defined with our three Hamiltonian.
Uh-huh.
And this is normal propagator.
Okay.
And then the pulsing gets more simple, so put the propagators there already in the various places.
Okay. Yeah, in any case, you have
already
given them those
papers. Yeah,
they
have. This copy.
Okay.
Oh, this was 17. 18. Ah, so here I'm going to calculate the Born term. Simply show how it works for the first term. We have here 19, and I do it in all detail. So first I insert this complete set of harmonic oscillator states. Actually, here I do not need that it is a harmonic oscillator. Here I do. This could now be anything, this one. Because the only thing I need from that potential
uh-huh.
is the wave functions
uh-huh.
and the spectrum.
Uh-huh.
That's all. So in principle, it could be any yes. potential.
Uh-huh.
That's the advantage. So I do such an insertion, and
okay.
then you see that the this operator acting on that thing gives me just the eigenenergy.
Okay.
So I just have the eigenenergies, and then I still have the potential terms.
And what you see in 27 is the final result, huh?
In 27. 28, 27, okay.
Of the Born term. Mm-hmm. So that's the potential in uh-huh. the Lippmann-Schwinger. So it's the Born term is the potential. And what you see is the potential is separable in P and P prime. Because you have a J of PA
mm-hmm.
and a J of P prime A.
Okay.
So it's separable. And because it's separable, you can just sum it all up.
Okay.
Yeah, so in the second order term, you just get this term quadratic.
Okay, this is the result at the first order.
Yes, and then is it the second order.
The second order.
And they show that you get this term just quadratic. So then you sum it up immediately. And then you have a series like x plus x squared plus x cubed, etc.
Uh-huh.
Very simple series.
So you have summed.
Yeah. Only before we arrive here, we need this interesting formula, which you probably don't know.
Which one?
Bauer's formula.
No, but this is well known.
You know?
Yes.
Perfect. So that one you need to do this angular integration.
So the only part is that you make of the potential that it is separable in the two variables.
In the relative momentum of initial and final state.
In the relative momentum.
So it's an energy dependent fact. It's separable, but it's also energy dependent. It's an energy dependent. Where does the energy dependence come from, of course? From the quark anti-quark sector.
No, but this makes sense because you are, let's say, practically you are solving respect one of the components. So
yep.
the effect of the other.
Exactly. So it's an effective potential,
uh-huh.
you get. And what you also see is that the delta function
uh-huh.
is now Fourier transformed into a Bessel function. Yeah. So that's are the JL of PA and the JL of P prime A. These
uh-huh.
are the Fourier transform of the delta shell interaction.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, when it is written that here, the point in which exactly you use the fact that potential is separable?
Well, in fact, Abe doesn't use it explicitly. In fact, after 27, You can just observe it separable and then write down immediately the exact T matrix for a separate potential, because you know that it's... You
because up to 27 he has not used the... In the writing up to 27...
No, up to 27 he has not used that it's separable.
And I didn't use it because I calculated second order and
yes.
calculated third order. Yes. I don't do that here in the paper. But and only then I was stupid enough to discover that it continued.
Okay.
And then the reason why this continues is that this separated.
Okay.
So then you get finally to the formula for the cotangent, which is written in 20 and here.
Now, okay, this is the point that in which I am interested. One moment. So now you write the, let's say, the scattering matrix, scattering amplitude, because from mm-hmm. P to P prime, essentially you have the T matrix, no?
Yes, here we have the full T matrix.
The full T matrix, and then, but what we need is the phase shift. The phase shift is related to the L.
I have here the relation.
In 33.
Our relation to
33, okay.
Now, but here's our relation between T and S.
Okay.
The relation which is used here, it's in all papers.
Ah, between T and S.
Yeah.
And then the phase.
S is given by E to the power 2 I delta.
Okay.
Yeah. That's very simple.
And so from that you get the.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because you can write S as cotangent delta plus I divided by cotangent delta minus I.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's a very simple relation because it's one channel, and the relation between S and the delta is very simple.
Okay, but let's say, can I say one stupid thing? But then you can sum from n going from 0 to infinity of that.
You can, in principle, you can.
In only principle, in the end of what you do.
In practice, it converges, or it converges slowly.
I've checked this convergence, and I think after 1 million terms, we had some 6 decimals. After 1 million terms, there are only some 6 decimals, okay. So it converges, but it converges very, very slow.
Very slow. So usually, when you make your calculation, up to which, how many terms do you put?
Yeah, but that's now we
that's
are
the next step.
Now
okay.
we are going to deviate.
Okay, one moment. So,
so
from that formula you get the phase shift, and thanks to the phase shift, practically you write the scattering matrix, and so you have something to compare with the spectrum.
We have everything.
Exactly.
And in fact, this can be generalized to many channels, so you have.
Okay.
But now we compare here the phase shift which we did this morning.
Uh-huh.
And the phase shift we arrive now.
Uh-huh.
They must be equal.
Uh-huh.
So I find the relation between these two terms.
Uh-huh.
And that is exactly the so-called spectral decomposition.
Okay. This is clear to you but not to me.
What?
This is clear to you, but for me it's not obvious.
But he has derived the same thing. The cotangent delta is the same. The
yeah.
only one, the only case you evaluate it exactly in coordinate space, in the other ways you evaluate it exactly in momentum space.
Ah, okay.
So it's the same coordinate, so these two expressions are the same?
Well, they should be the same.
Yes.
But why it is called spectral decomposition? Sorry. A stupid question.
Yeah, that you can check that question. You have internet, huh?
Uh-huh.
Can we go to the
uh-huh.
to this lecture notes which we saw this morning? Just from there.
Okay.
You get there. The lecture notes still were there, I think. So, yeah, this one.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have to check here in the end, the last page, I think, the very last page.
And the
end.
Okay.
I don't know where it is. Number, yeah. Year number 8 from the references. Yeah, exactly. So it's this book, Handbook of Feynman Pass Integrals from Drosje and Steiner.
Uh-huh.
They apparently have this formula explained.
The formula of
the spectral decomposition.
Of the spectral decomposition.
It's a spectral decomposition of the Green's function.
Spectral decomposition of Green's function.
This is the Green's function.
Okay.
So you are looking actually at in what is in our model, the full Green's function.
Okay. Okay.
So, what in diagrams? I think we have this. So, meson. And here is, oh, that's not a good notation. Small m. M.
Okay.
Meson. And then we change in the s direction
uh-huh.
a mass.
Okay.
But I do not exchange just this mass, no, I exchange also a mass M1
uh-huh.
and a mass M2.
Uh-huh.
Plus, etc.
Okay.
But then they also include diagrams of this type, where this can be mass 8 and that can be mass 19.
It's all included.
And then we have so all these diagrams plus, okay. And then we have of course those.
And any number of
so what we have actually, the whole thing summed up, is the complete
full property.
Okay. That's what we do.
Okay.
And but what you show actually is that you can do it in two ways. You can do it just solving Schrödinger equation, or you can do it in this strictly perturbative way.
Right.
Now the beauty of the perturbative way is that now you can start doing physics. You can say, well, this vertices here, what kind of things do I want here? Is there something better I can imagine in this vertex? Because the vertex in the formula has just the function of the harmonic oscillator square.
Uh-huh.
But that's a bit silly.
No, but the vertex is the Bessel. The vertex is the Bessel.
Yeah, but the coupling. The
coupling, not coupling.
The coupling is this, and that's a bit silly because that depends on the distance A very much and can oscillate, go up and down, etc. So the first thing you might like to move to attack is actually the vertex. So change this here. Another thing which you immediately will change is of course the non-relativistic kinematics.
Yeah.
So okay. You can immediately change the to relativistic kinematics. But the most I think what we did is this part, we changed that to what we call the RSE. Is the resonance spectrum expansion. Now if we can go to this machine again, then I can show you. We go to my talks. We start from my homepage just now. Somewhere, yeah. And then we have your conferences, yeah? Good. And then we take the fusion connections.
Just a second.
Okay.
I am entered to the network.
Try again.
the last line of the first item. Threshold, etc. Yeah. Okay. Then there should be a start here. Exactly. And now wait a second. If I get my glasses,
stop. Is that?
Now that I managed to see that.
We have to go to strong, yeah. Strong, good. T matrix, probably. T matrix, yeah. That's probably correct. Here I do in pictures, if you start with Breitling, you see in pictures everything I told. So this is the general T matrix. In the next line, we look at the width. So people take this as the width and say then, okay, the imaginary part of the width. But forget about the shift. Actually, the idea is that the pole moves also, so the peak changes. And then we have the meson loops, which are inserted, so we have all these loops, etc. So this is just in pictures what I talked about. we continue a little bit more. So this is the same formula. There is no difference between this formula and that formula, so the right angle is the same. But in this formula I have an advantage. If I now click one more, I can just insert all those the whole spectrum. And then go to that. Exactly. So I have here now sum over n. And now I have to explain why I put here a g and not fa squared. So I, from here on I take here a certain, and that's in this three. Look, here's given exactly how to calculate this. Well, it's given in these two articles, but how to calculate these three meson vertices in the harmonic oscillator approximation.
Okay.
Many people have done it for one, for a few values of angular momentum. Radio excitations, there are very few articles, and they all don't need to do this because I already did it in 83 and 84. It's given. So you just copy the formula and put it in Fortran or in Mathematica or whatever. And then you get formula. So that is.
Do you know how to work with Mathematica?
Yeah. Complicated thing. This vacuum is just. Come back. This vacuum is just a joke. If you click there. Something from JLab, which they probably don't want to know. Oh, they have taken it away.
The JLab claimed that they had found other quantum numbers for the vacuum. And that case was still there already for 5-6 years. During my talks, it was still visible half a year ago, but now it's not.
Okay, but so that's the idea to how to calculate it given here and in these two articles. It's a bit complicated, but you have many parameters which give the masses then. And the general idea is that if I put here mass n, so I couple meson to mass n. Then the coupling, so, or let's say, no, this is nonsense. If I, where can I get some blackboard? No, whiteboard. Here, I never work with this pencil. So if I just have this vertex, metal. And here mass n, so this is the nth radial excitation. Then I find that this coupling here, gn squared, is proportional to 4 to the minus n. And the couplings come 4 to the 4th power in the transition amplitude. So it means that.
Now in the cross section.
The radial or in the cross section.
Yeah.
It means that the nth radial excitation couples very weak to a certain meson-meson channel in comparison to the ground state. So if you start at the ground state.
Okay, this part to the minus n.
Yeah, but it's not the only, you also have other dependents. Mm-hmm. So it can be that for small n, that it can be more or less, how shall I say, not going down very fast. Only for large n, it will go down quickly.
Okay, but this is the fact that it goes down quickly for large n, is what helps you to have the convergence.
Yes, exactly. That's the convergence.
This is the key ingredient to have the convergence. So,
it's basically because you have overlaps, right, because you have overlaps with many nodes. When there are many nodes, then overlaps will tend to go to zero.
But this is because we have all harmonic oscillator wave function. From what comes out this minus sign? Because this is a key ingredient. Because without that suppression,
you never
converge.
Yeah, but I think it's because of the nodes.
Timothy Burns has calculated them partly in harmonic oscillator basis. He gets a similar result. So
Burns, he was at the workshop.
He made the same calculation?
Yes,
similar.
Just a few months ago.
And what did he found?
It's a similar result.
So the electric P0 coupling for going up n goes as 4 to the minus n.
With the harmonic oscillator, you have an advantage.
But this is for harmonic oscillator, this behavior.
The harmonic oscillator, you have the ground state, next state, next state, and they are degenerate.
Yes.
But I know how large is the degeneracy of each of the states.
Okay.
So if I go higher and higher and higher, I know every time how large is the degeneracy.
Yes, because there is a way to calculate automatically.
Now what I find is that the number of possible meson-meson channels to which one certain radial excitation couples, that number grows very, very fast.
Okay.
So let's say for the ground state it may be some, let's say, 10 channels. For the first radial excitation it are already 50 channels. For the second radial excitation it are already 500 channels. And it goes up. I have a program which calculates all.
Okay.
And for I think the fourth or the fifth radial excitation, I get 33 pages of possible meson-meson channels.
Okay.
What does that mean? That means if you look at a specific meson-meson channel, say pion-pion, then the fraction of pion-pion in between all the possible configurations which are possible becomes very small fraction, so hardly will decay. Now, if you look at it, if you look at DD bar, for instance, cross sections, what you find is that the general tendency is, and then you have the resonances here. But the general tendency is that the cross section goes down very rapidly.
This is because of conservation of
the
probability, because
you
cannot divide.
Yes, because you have many, many more channels.
Yes. Since it's a key ingredient of your model, I want to be sure that I have understood the truth exactly. This n is the radial. Is the radial quantum number, the number of the node, the number that counts the node in the wave function, the harmonic oscillator wave function. So you are telling me that, but in some sense it's also linked to the number of shell.
The number of what?
Of shell. No.
The number of what?
Shells.
Yeah, degeneracy.
So
that's what you mean.
For you, this n is only the radial, the number of nodes.
Yes.
is the number, not the number of shells.
What shells?
Or levels, the harmonic oscillator level.
Yeah, it is the level, but it corresponds to the nodes.
But correspond to the?
If you have the ground state, the n equals 0 has 0 nodes, the n equals 1 has 1 node, the n equals
yes.
2 has 2 nodes.
Yes, but there is also...
The L, you also have the orbital angular momentum, but
so,
that's also...
But in that formula you have put the n, not the total n.
What is the total n?
The principal quantum number. This is only the number that counts the nodes.
Yeah, what you mean is this number. It's 2n plus L.
Exactly.
No,
that's this number. What you
yes,
mean.
Why you have put only small n and not the other?
I don't put the result of my calculus is that it goes proportional to this.
Yes.
To the small n.
Yeah. But of course, for different L, the result will be different in general. So Abe has tabulated these things. But if you have different L's, the values will be different. But also there you will get the same kind of large N dependence.
You can show some.
I can show, I have got the tables here. Yeah.
So, you understand, I'm not questioning, but really I can question in the sense that I want to be sure. So, this kind of things convert independently also of L.
Yes.
It's not a stupid question, my question.
No, it's not independent of L,
but it's,
I say it's proportional. I don't
so
say
you can be sure that in any case this thing is suppressed. When you go sufficiently high, it is suppressed so you can converge. This is my point.
I've not put this.
Huh?
I've not put this.
No, exactly.
It is the asymptotic dependence.
It is.
Okay.
So this is just a small subset. Huh?
Okay.
He considers certain, because what is relevant is the quantum numbers of the state. So Abe has tables for zero scalar,
okay.
For scalar,
okay.
For vector,
okay.
But also vector, which is this is triplet S1 because the L is 0,
okay.
And this is triplet D1 because L is 2.
Okay.
And now if you compare these tables with these, you will see that the numbers are different.
Okay.
Okay, but let's go there then. Okay, let's go first to the triplet S1.
And I can make at any instance so, another table for whatever
okay. So these are the isospin dependents,
okay.
Yeah, the SU3 part.
Okay.
This SU3 part, this is independent of N.
Okay.
Then you have the numbers for N equals 0.
Okay.
Yeah. You see what are, so we are looking at the vector meson, which is both, furthermore, it's a triplet S1 component. Because triplet S1 triplet will mix, so you have an additional complication. But this is only for the triplet S1 component. For the ground state, for n equals 0, you have these possibilities. Now, let's look at them. This is a pseudo scalar plus a pseudo vector.
Uh-huh.
This, you see, a pseudo vector has an internal n equals 1 because it's a pseudo vector state, this one.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an internal n equals 0. So this is a ground state pseudo vector state. Okay? And what you see then is the relative quantum numbers here. It has a relative quantum L equals 0, so this is an S wave.
Uh-huh.
It has a total spin 1.
Okay.
Yeah. And it has a relative radial quantum number 0, which is not so important. Okay. And then here you have the squares of the couplings. You have two different cases with the sign, but okay, that's not so important now. Then you have the next channel is zero scalar plus axial vector. Okay, so besides the pseudo scalar, pseudo vector, you have axial vector is 1 plus plus. Then you have,
okay.
Etc. This is for n equals 0. It's
okay.
It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 channels. But now if you go to the next case, for n different from 0.
Right.
Yeah, now look at the number of, and here you have the n dependence. Recoupling coefficients times
okay.
4 to the power
okay.
n. And here you have, so it's not only 4 to the minus n, you also have this in. The 4 to the n is in the denominator, but in the numerator you have these factors, okay, which Abe had not specified. But these are mild. For large n, of course, this will dominate, okay, the 4 to the minus n.
But this is written not for to the mind.
No, because he has tabulated the coupling times 4 to the power. So the coupling is this divided by 4
okay.
to the power.
This is obvious to you, but not to me,
okay.
because it's not written
so,
that way.
So this is the triplet S1 case, but now we go to triplet D1.
Okay.
And then you see that you have similar tables, but you have, for instance, for N equals 0, now you have many more channels already. Even for the ground state, you have many more channels.
I understand.
Okay?
Now that's not really the ground state. You have to be careful. The S is the ground state. Here you have an S and a D. D is...
Yes.
It's already an excitation.
No, but you can consider L equal, N equals 0,
no,
L equals 2.
I have to check it, that's no problem.
Okay.
Pronto? Ciao. Scusate, un momento, scusa. But you can continue, I will be back in a few times. I have to answer it.
But you can show them the next N equals 1, the state or something.
You mean which one?
Look in the index. The index.
Oh, here is, for instance, tensor mesons. Yeah? Which has.
No, but in the index, you have an index.
Yeah, okay. But you have a finite number of cases studied. Here is the tensor meson with L equals 3. So this would be. This tensor would be. What you call triplet P2. This is triplet P2, okay, in the spectroscopic notation. And this tensor, because it has L equals 3, is the triplet F2.
Yeah,
because it's L equals 3. This is the same notation as you're using in your page. You can also use it in the question. Okay, long tables. Next case, the axial vector, 1 plus plus. Which the axial vector, it means triplet P1. Okay?
Okay.
And one table. Then this is the pseudo vector, which means singlet P1. Okay. And so on. I mean, this is just, you should realize that you have in principle many channels, but if you look which channels are relevant, because most of these channels will be closed. And some of them will be very high in mass.
Okay.
So in practical calculations, of course, you don't include all of them.
Okay.
The next case is this one, the 3 minus minus, which is a triplet. What the heck? I forget now. What is a 3 minus minus? That's
the
triplet D3, huh?
It's a vector.
Triplet D3.
It's a vector.
It has j equals 3, so it's j. It is 3 there. And you must have l equals 2, and it's a negative parity. Yeah, it's triplet BD. Triplet D3.
L equals
2. Triplet D3. And so on. Okay. I mean, it can produce any case. So if you want a certain case, you will run the program and produce the table.
Okay.
So what you see is, for each different L, he will produce you couplings as a function of N. But the couplings, of course, also depend on L. But the asymptotic dependence, what determines the asymptotic fall-off, is the N and not the L.
Okay.
And this is probably due to the notes. Because each additional M adds an additional node to the wave function. And if you have many nodes, then overlaps become smaller and smaller.
Yep. Can you show me the index? Because I think there's a case where you have really a lot of channels.
Well, this already is many. I mean, the tensor is already. Look at this.
Oh yeah.
This is many, many, many.
Yeah.
The tensor has already many.
Yeah, of course. Let's see.
And the trips.
that it was continued.
Which mean Gien? Gien, which mean?
What is this?
Gien.
The M?
Gien.
Gien, it's these couplings. These are the squares of the couplings.
Okay.
These are the squares, okay? Because the G is the square root of these numbers. They are all rational numbers. You see, these are rational numbers.
Okay.
The squares of the G's are rational numbers. In principle, you could do the same for a different confining potential. But it will be very hard. But in principle, you could do something similar, numerically.
By the way, do you know how to program in Fortran?
Yes, C++? Yes. Yeah. And also, I asked already to Hugo that he wants to work with Mathematica.
Yeah, and, well, I want to say something about Mathematica, because a student in Coimbra programmed this formulas for these couplings in Mathematica. And we wanted to go more general, because actually what George showed you is only for equal part masses.
Okay.
But we wanted something for heavy masses and light masses.
Yes.
So that's included in the formalism, so the my program is completely prepared to do this calculus, but I never did it. Then she programmed that in Mathematica. And one day she came to me complaining that Mathematica took 24 hours to produce only one coupling.
Mm-hmm.
And I told her, well, that's unbelievable. And I say, wait a second, I go to my program. So I went to my program to see the structure of the program. What do I find? I find that the important part which has to be changed is right in the center. So all the summing is centered around this one point. So it was very easy for me to change and to make instead of numerical results there analytic. So I told her, come back in 2 hours. I changed what was necessary, and then when she came, I told her, okay, I push the button, everything was on the screen, I put it on the printer, here you have it. Now check, please, once you have calculated if it's correct. Yeah, from the tables, which were some 50 formulas for all the couplings, she had checked already some 5, and they were all in agreement. So we assumed that the rest also was okay. So Fortran did the calculus for all table in a fraction of a second, and Mathematica took for in one line 24 hours.
Oh my goodness.
So now, just to warn you, either you make very clever, maybe you can do it more clever in Mathematica, I don't know. But you have to be pretty clever to do it fast. Fortran is in a sense much faster.
Yes, indeed.
And I also do, what do you call it, analytical calculus with Fortran. So not only numbers. Okay.
Okay, I work in both. Some things I did in Fortran and other things in mathematics.
For this business, it's fundamental to be able to work with complex numbers.
No, I think the simple formula for just the cross sections, that will not be a problem. That you can do in both Mathematica or in Fortran. But if you want to calculate more complicated stuff, that you get more channels, etc., then I think Mathematica is not very easy.
Thank you.